Welcome everyone tonight. Thank you for being here at the Artisan Conversation series we're having for this show, Three the Hard Way. We have here Ayana Contreras, one of our artisan residents, and Richard Steele, who's gonna be our moderator tonight. And I just wanna tell you a little bit about them. Oh, and my name is Camille Morgan. I'm the Logan Center Exhibition's curatorial coordinator. So Ayana is an artist that works in sound. Her artistic process revolves around the idea of creative reuse as a means of building community. She hosts and produces a show called Reclaimed Soul on Vocalo 91.1. And each program features an all-vinyl soundtrack from her extensive personal collection, as well as original audio documentaries about people who are using old items for new artistic or cultural endeavors. She also interviews original Chicago soul artists and musicians. Ayana additionally produces a radio program called The Barbershop Show, broadcast live from a barbershop in North Lawndale, which airs on Vocalo and WBEZ. Ayana was a 2011 Dorchester Projects resident artist, and her website is ayanacontreras.wordpress.com. Among other things. And Richard Steele here to my left has worked in radio for 47 years, including the past 27 years at Chicago's WBEZ FM. In recent years, Steele has been a frequent contributor to such WBEZ programs such as The Morning Shift, Afternoon Shift, Worldview, Morning Edition, All Things Considered, and 848, all of which I listen to, all of them. Who here listens to these shows? Yay! Yeah, they're amazing. Since fall of 2010, Steele has been the host of The Barbershop Show on WBEZ FM's sister station, also known as Vocalo. Produced in collaboration with the Chicago Reporter, The Barbershop Show is recorded on location at Carter's Barbershop in Chicago's North Lawndale neighborhood. Each week, Steele moderates discussions on issues impacting the local community, and the show airs at noon on Fridays and Saturdays on WBEW FM, as well as being broadcast on WBEZ each Sunday afternoon, which is when I listen to it. Although Steele stepped away from his full-time position at WBEZ last October, he isn't fully retiring from radio just yet. And he still plans on hosting his weekly program, The Barbershop Show. And he kindly graces us with his presence tonight as he is in conversation with Ayana, this year's Arts and Public Life Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture Artists in Residence. So let's welcome them tonight. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. I could have cut that down to what, like two lines. So, yeah. So we're going to talk about Three the Hard Way. Ayana Contreras is the artist, and she is also the producer of The Barbershop Show. And if you haven't had a chance to hear Reclaim Soul, this is a show that is exclusively hers, music from her own collection. You should really check that out. It's a, you get to learn about a lot of things concerning soul music that you might not have known before, you think you might know, or stuff you haven't heard that you get a chance to go, whoa, I never heard that before, because I do that all the time. And I was playing that music for a lot of years, but I missed some of it. She connects with all of it. So this is about Three the Hard Way. So my first question is, and I asked this before we started, so I'm not surprising you. Why is it called Three the Hard Way?
You got to ask Hamza Walker, the curator of the show, specifically why it's called that. Outside of the fact that it's three artists, I'm not 100% sure. I can't be in his head. But I mean, I can say that Three the Hard Way is a movie that has Chicago connections, including the impressions are briefly in it, and they sang the soundtrack, and the soundtrack was recorded here, and yada, 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 yada. But I don't know that that's it. I think there's some other ties as well.
Anybody here familiar with Three the Hard Way? It was a black exploitation movie. It was called Three the Hard Way.
1974.
The interesting thing about that movie, and I was doing music radio at that point, was that the program director of WVON, which was the major black station at that point, was a guy named E. Rodney Jones, and he made a cameo appearance in the movie. And when they had the showing of the movie, a special showing for the radio station, and all these people showed up, I forgot which theater downtown, and but it was packed. And when Rodney showed up on the screen, the place went crazy. He wasn't even a star, he was a star in Chicago. That was kind of interesting. The other thing about that movie is It was shot mostly in California, but some of it was shot here in Chicago. So while we were looking at the movie, you ever watch a movie that you live in the place where the movie was shot and you recognize, when they made a mistake or where places, they jumped from one place to another and you say, well, that didn't make sense because that's not next to that place. Well, unfortunately, in that movie, they did that and they would go from one scene to a next in a couple of instances where it was a Chicago location and then the next location was Los Angeles. If you live here, you go, or in either of the cities, you go, that's not cool, And one other quick thing, Jim Kelly, one of the stars of the movie, was kind of a Johnny-come-lately actor. He was really a martial arts guy who got into the movies. So his thing in the movie was to kick a lot of people in the face, right, which he did. So the scene would show him in street shoes and street clothes, and then they got into a fight, and the next minute when he was doing the karate thing, he'd have gym shoes on, so that, the editing thing, you go, I just saw that. You didn't have those shoes on 5 seconds ago, So we paid real close attention during those days to movies that reflected, not totally reflected us, but there were so few things on the screen. This black exploitation period gave African Americans an opportunity to say, there's some people on the screen that look like me. And so we paid attention to every detail of every movie. And that's my little Three the Hard Way story.
It's more than I had, really, Richard. I interviewed the guy in the pink turtleneck on the album from The Impressions. How about that? Yay! He was not wearing a pink turtleneck at that time, but.
Hey, So this exhibit, your part of this exhibit has to do with what exactly? Can you kind of explain?
Well, essentially, I'm going to read this little write-up since I spent the time to write it, right? Essentially, it's when I look at, I collect records, many, many thousands of records, but I also collect other ephemeral items. So that could be anything from a flyer from an event to a press release from an album to a magazine, books. But generally, what I'm most interested in are things that weren't meant to be kept and things that were very immediate. And I'm interested in sort of the dialogue that these items have and the potency in terms of what they're communicating, the potency that they still have to me as 2015 person, right? A lot of the stuff, obviously, Hamza and I had a long discussion about the role that nostalgia should or should not have in art. And what I was trying to express to him was that a lot of these older items, to me, are not particularly nostalgic because I was born in the 80s, right? Like, I was born after that point, and so I'm not tied to, I remember when, whatever. Like, I'm more attracted to.
I think I'm offended by that.
Well, no, I mean, there's nothing wrong with nostalgia, not necessarily the emotion that I'm personally having.
Sure.
And my attraction to it. I think when I talk about the dialogue, what I'm thinking about is how relevant a lot of these things still are to me today. And as a person who's looking at some of these things that are 40, 50 years old, and some of my ephemeral items are much, much older than that, I'm wondering, this feedback loop, right? That we're in this feedback loop of societal issues, like when are we gonna break out of that? And so that was sort of what was scrolling in my mind when I was trying to pick items that I wanted to display. And also, another thing that I'm attracted to in terms of album covers especially is that they're this perfect visual representation of something that is just not visual, right? Like, for instance, one of my favorites is the one in the top left-hand corner that says Black Power. I mean, obviously the fist, people know that, and it's been appropriated multiple times for multiple purposes, but that particular album, what's interesting to me is that it's just very, very simple and very, very basic, but the story behind it is that it's a compilation of singles that was released on Chess Records 1970, but it was only made for distribution in Brazil. So that's a Brazilian record of records coming out of Chicago that were expressing black power, you know what I mean, to Brazilians who that was revolutionary to them. And they were having their own struggle of black power. And I just thought that that's just such an amazing thing that if you remove the image from the record, you don't have that background.
So I guess, I wonder, and when you told me that story, and I'm sure it's as much of a surprise to this audience as it was to me when we talked about it, how did you come across that?
You know, I am a person who, I'm not a hoarder, but I'm always...
Yeah, right. Yeah,
I'm
right,
not,
right.
I'm not. You. People, some folks in here have been to
this
my house.
This is true, she's not. Because,
and it's not. I'm ruthless in what I don't keep.
When we're working on items for the show, if we don't use it right away, and I don't have it on my desk, and it's on her desk,
gone. Because some stuff's got to go. You can't keep everything. I mean, that's the whole thing, right? Because what happens when people find out that you collect old things is you become the land of misfit old people stuff. So people call you and like, come get my stuff, but you have to get everything. And then you've got 18 copies of the best of, you know, I don't know, you name that person that you don't really want. But
I just told you to come get some records. You
I know, I'm coming, though. I'm coming.
You don't have to take them all.
I'm coming.
You know?
But you know what I'm...
I mean...
It's a blessing and a curse, though. You know what I mean? You have to be respectful. And this is the other thing about collecting other people's collections, right? Like, for me, it is actually important, too, if I can keep somebody's collection together as much as possible to keep it. Because the way in which a person collects things and the way in which a person listened to music in 1965 says a lot about that moment in time. And I think it's important to have it, you know. But at the same time, you have to be mindful that... What is the essence of that? Do you know what I mean? As opposed to me just having hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of somebody's records. Like, there's this woman, Beverly. She collected 45s. She had huge, what do you call those things? Those storage bins full of 45s, which frightened me because they weren't in sleeves and it was really terrible. But I had to really think about, like, oh, my God, I could hear her sound based on the records. And it's like, what would be the representational records.
Well, for some people, but because what you have is so eclectic, if I listened to stuff, I wouldn't know if that's Ayana.
I don't know, maybe.
It's pretty eclectic.
That's true. There's a lot of eclectic stuff that I'm into. I'm into a lot of different things, but I think I see it as a series of collections within collections.
Okay, so one of the things that I think this represents, and if I'm wrong, correct me on this, would lead to the question of what the visual symbols tell us about the 60s and 70s relating to black culture. One of the things that's in there, we're going to talk about advertising and the use of black images in advertising. In the mid 60s, there might have been, I think I read where about 3% of the advertising used African Americans, black people, in ads. And by the end of the 70s, it was about 12%, which is approximately equal to the population of African Americans in the United States. And so that's how it gradually changed. And there were some reasons for that. There's some things that you represented in this exhibit.
Right. And specifically, the stuff that I have in here are things that I think people are still kind of grappling with, like that particular case over there has a lot of imagery of black models. And there was a magazine that someone gave me, right? Like someone at work actually, they were like, look, you like black people, take this old Life magazine with Naomi Sims on the cover. I was like, thanks. It's interesting because it's got this spread saying that, you know, black models have arrived in 1969. And today, you still have black models saying, where are we represented on the runway, like, you know, 45 years later, which I think is kind of ironic.
And, you know, I put them on my phone, and the variety of, when you get a chance, you look at that, the different, you started that, not started that segment off, but about three pieces in, there's the cover from the album for the movie
Cotton Comes to Harlem. Yes.
So the significance of that.
You know what's interesting?
Anybody see Cotton Comes to Harlem? All the black people saw it. Okay.
So. Yeah, the thing about that cover is...
Big natural.
Yeah.
Woman had a big natural.
It's like, it's beautiful and it's exploitational at the same time. And how can that be? And you grapple with that a little bit because it really is a beautiful cover. The art itself is beautiful. And
it
then,
is.
And the other thing is the soundtrack is by like this white Canadian dude who was known for doing soulful, funky music. And you think about that, layer that in there, and it's like, okay. And this is also interesting is because Cotton Come to Harlem in the continuum of blaxploitational films is actually on the earlier end of it. You know, around Sweet, Badass, da-da-da-da-da, but way before some of the later ones. So it's interesting that...
That reference was to Sweet Sweetback's Badass
everybody's
song.
I didn't want to say the whole thing. It's long. I need an acronym. But
this is the University of Chicago. We can say whatever we want.
Well, y'all... But it's interesting that that particular movie, they felt like they needed a white guy to do the score. But later on, after, you know, Isaac Hayes and them proved themselves, then everybody and their dog did a soundtrack. I told you about, and you were like, what? That Barry White did a soundtrack.
For
a movie. Jerry Butler did a soundtrack for the film Melinda.
Yeah, I know he did, right.
A whole lot of folks did a soundtrack. You know, of course, Marvin Gaye, but the list is extremely long.
Marvin Gaye's was Trouble Man.
Right, exactly. But the list is very long. Yeah.
This was a pretty significant period in Hollywood for people who would do soundtracks. I think Quincy Jones was probably the first one who really got acceptance on a larger scale to do movie soundtracks. And after Isaac Hayes did Shaft, and it sort of opened the doors.
It did. And what's and he, you know, won like awards for that.
Got a Grammy.
Right. Well, that's a big deal.
Ayana's that big on the Grammys.
I'm not big on Grammys. Like real. The thing about Grammys, right? Okay, if you go back in the history of what won Grammys and what didn't, and you're like, oh my God, this didn't get a Grammy? How did Marvin Gaye not get a Grammy until the 80s? Come on now. Come on. Let's think about that.
I'm just saying.
Yeah. We'll just leave that there.
Okay.
But I mean, you know, the other thing to think about when you think about... I think we actually do a disservice when we talk about that era as being the blaxploitation era, because the good thing about those films that were sometimes really terrible and had terrible production quality and continuity was totally whack, but they allowed certain real, honest-to-God pieces of black cinema to kind of slip in, like Claudine, for instance, or The River Niger, which was a play that was beautiful. Or Five on the Black Hand Side, which again was on Broadway. I mean, there's these films that kind of get lost in the shuffle a little bit, but they were actually great. Or even, I would even add into that category Cornbread Earl and Me, which is based on Hog Butcher, which was a book about Chicago.
Yeah, that was
right?
Pretty
I don't know if you ever, you should read Hog Butcher if you hadn't. Ronald Fair, a Chicago author, wrote it about him growing up in the Black Belt of Chicago.
So. And as a film, it's very uniquely done in black and white, and it's Hog Butcher.
You're talking about Killer Sheep.
No, last year's Black Harvest Film Festival.
Killer Sheep. Well, Hog Butcher. Okay, wait. Okay, Killer Sheep is a Charles Burnett black and white 1970s film from L.A. I am not a film person, but I'm an old film person. In the other film. Hog Butcher is the book based on Cornbread Earl and Me. That's the one where they're like, cornbread!
I'm familiar with it.
Yeah. Yeah, right?
Thanks.
Lawrence Fishburne was in it. Yeah. That one's not, yeah. And Rosalind Cash, whom I love. Oh, my God.
She's a fantastic actress.
She's fantastic.
Let me ask you a question. And one of the things that we want to talk about, I think, is about some of the things in the exhibit that you've chosen. What questions do they pose? You and I talked about the significance of some of the things as we look at them today and how, and you mentioned that at the beginning of what you had to say, how there's sort of a carryover effect in terms of some of the things that they bring to the fore as issues are still issues. Did they ever not become issues or just a carryover from the 1960s, 1970s? There's part of the exhibit over there which is a book that asked the question, I think there's something put out by the Black Panthers.
Right, yeah.
About what to do if you're stopped by the police.
That's a Ebony magazine from, I think.
Was it Ebony?
Yeah, late 1960, I think 68, something in that neighborhood, which obviously is, I mean, when this was
says
put
what
up,
to do, what to do if arrested.
Yeah.
That was out of Ebony?
But that's something that's been an ongoing thing, right? There was a green book that was put out back in, like, I think maybe the 1940s initially, that was distributed to African-American drivers driving throughout the country, suggesting where it was safe to stay and where what places were sunset towns.
It was not only places safe to stay, it was places to go get your hair done, get your car fixed.
Yeah, all that.
It was available on the internet a couple of years ago, and I printed it out. It was pretty thick.
Yeah.
And so it was interesting to look at because it meant that if you were driving cross-country and you happened to be black, it wasn't like you just stopped anywhere like today, you know, where you can stop at a motel or stop to get something to eat. You had to use that guide so you wouldn't get into trouble. And it listed all kinds of things, services that you would need if you were driving cross-country. This green book, and I can't remember who put it out, but it was out for a number of years.
He was in New York. I can't remember what his name was, but he was based
in New
York. And he would suggest people come visit him if you were ever in New York to come visit.
Did anybody hear of that ever? About the book, the green book? Yeah, it was online for a while. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting when you talk about things like that because if you know, it's within the culture, if you happen to be black, those are things that you might know about or hear about through your parents or grandparents. But if you're not black, it's kind of like that. I guess it would be kind of hard to envision. Well, gee, that's interesting. You had to have a specific guidebook to let you know just simple things like hospitals. All that stuff was in this book for across the country for a lot of major cities. Interesting. The way people had to live during that period, where we had to live.
Right.
So these questions that are presented as questions in terms of what's on display, and then you know whether or not there's a carryover. What other questions come up when you look at this stuff, or should come up?
Well, I don't want to say should come up.
Do come up.
I think it's probably dependent on the person who's looking at it. Like my last exhibition, which was at the Arts Incubator. It was really based, you saw that one as well. It was based on sort of the Black Power era in Chicago specifically. It was very specifically about this moment in Chicago where we were creating these items that were really expressing Black Power through entrepreneurship, like people's different advertisements were saying, you know, black is beautiful, all the way to the music, all the way to cultural events. Like it was just permeating in the ephemeral material that was coming out of Chicago during that time. And so there was a woman who came in and she cried because she had a direct connection to a piece that was in there. And she was like, I never thought I would see any of this ever again. You know?
Yeah, there was an agency, which I believe was the first black advertising agency to make a difference, the Vince Colors Agency. Mm-hmm. And that was part of your exhibit.
Right, that was one of the ads that was blown up.
I'm so old, I knew Vince Colors.
And it was from a Black Expo program, the first Black Expo. And basically what it wound up is many, many dozens of pages, but it was essentially a yearbook of the black businesses in Chicago in about 1968, 1969. And just to see the breadth and depth and variety of businesses that were, you know, everybody from Baldwin Ice Cream to Gladys's Luncheonette. And I mean, it was just, and boutiques, little boutiques that might've been there for a blip of time, but you know, they were present in that piece of material. I think that was valuable. But then, you know, you had the person who cried, right? But then on the other side of the spectrum, a guy from Germany walks up to me and is like, so what is this Jet magazine? I don't know what, and that's cool, right? Like everybody has a different entry point, but I mean, I'm hoping that there are questions that come from it. I guess if there's questions, then I'm doing my job. If it's sparking inquiry, we'll say.
So the cover to the Black Panther Party, this piece, where did that come from?
That is...
Which is over there.
Did someone give me that or did I find it in a junk? I think I bought that, yeah. The Chicago Seed was basically a kind of revolutionary kind of alternative reader from the north side of Chicago. And on the cover, they had, they were covering the Chicago 8 trial. And it was an interesting cover. And there's like a Bobby Seale poster inside. And it was just beautiful. And again, newspapers are probably some of the most ephemeral material you'll ever see, because who would keep that? Like, why? And whoever kept it had the date on it because it was important to them, like March of 19. They hand wrote it on there. And so I was like, bless you, because otherwise I don't know that I would have seen this. Although someone here in this audience has one as well.
I never saw that until I saw it.
Yeah, well, I have another one that's even weirder. It's put together by this group of white activists in Uptown who were originally from the South. I don't know if people know about this. There was a large contingency of white Southerners who moved to Uptown. And so anyway, they were allies for the cause of
anybody
black
ever hear
liberation.
Of Slim Coleman? Okay.
And it was fast. This particular thing, the poetry in it was just like really deep. But it was this little slice of story, because what we think of, right, is that it's always been very black and white culture in Chicago, and to a large extent. That's true. In a lot of communities, it's true, especially borderlands. But there were some inroads. There was even a group, one of my friends, he's an older man, older white man. He's older. But I'm saying that to
the
say
older
that
man reference,
he's an
I think
older
I
man.
Have
I mean,
issue
what am, I,
that,
not, what am I not supposed to reference
I'm just kidding.
Age?
I'm just kidding.
I appreciate
I'm
age.
I'm just kidding.
He was in a group called Rising Up Angry, which was like another a radical white group that was trying to form alliances with radical black folks in Chicago.
Yeah, I threw a name in there a minute ago. I think somebody over there recognized
the
name.
He likes to make sure that I know that all the time.
Slim Coleman was a guy who was very much involved with the civil rights movement in Chicago. I think he at one point, and he was a Southerner, and I think he at one point attended Harvard years before he came to Chicago, but he became very much involved with the movement as a spokesperson. He was on television a lot and was a pretty aggressive speaker and a guy that was interesting to listen to, but he represents exactly what you're talking about in that respect. I do want to bring up something else here that was another piece here. This is a piece, was this also Ebony? A psychiatrist looks at black power, Alvin
yes.
Poussin?
Yeah, definitely Ebony.
That's over there too.
The thing about this, right? Okay, so I don't know if there's anybody in the house who worked at Ebony or Jet or anything like that.
Other than me.
Outside of you, I'm gonna choose my words carefully. My oldest Ebony is 1947. I collect a lot of them very seriously, and I think Ebony and Jet did, especially Jet, did an amazing job of actually asking certain questions in kind of a palatable way. Like, they actually went there in a lot of ways. And that's based on Poussin, that's based on Lerone Bennett and some other folks that were putting these things out here for consumption of grandmama, right? Unfortunately, what it turned into later on, and probably when a lot of folks who grew up in the 80s, their knowledge of Ebony and Jet, it became like this society pages about what Halle Berry is doing to keep Slim. And so, I mean, just stuff. I mean, I'm not saying it was completely irrelevant, but I think it became something else than what it was during this era where it was really...
It transitioned
with
the
times.
It was
aspirational, but at the same time, it was talking about civil rights issues. Yeah, and I think to be able to toggle back and forth between that is a reputable, honorable thing, and I think it's a thing that we still need today. And I wish that they would stop talking about Halle Berry. I mean, you know what I'm saying, though. Like, I feel like that still needs to happen.
But listen,
that's my point.
The deal is it's realistically, it's difficult financially to maintain a footing.
Period.
So what Johnson did was there's a publication called Black World. Are you familiar with that? It was where black writers who had an alternative point of view would be able to write and get things published. It was not as widely recognized as Ebony was, but it was his way of mm-hmm. allowing for an opportunity, an opportunity for people to express these feelings. But it's when you have Johnson had, I mean, he really had to juggle to get mm-hmm. that magazine going. I mean, does anybody know has heard the story about how he, when he first published, and he was trying to get the magazine on newsstands, and there was sort of a monopoly in terms of newsstands and stuff that they carried. So he had some people go out and ask all these different newsstands for Ebony magazine, and they said, we don't carry it. And he sort of forced the issue. So he had to do a lot of juggling in order to, so then you have the magazine, if you go too far with this magazine, then the advertising issue comes up and it becomes
so
a problem.
It was a toggle. So it wasn't like everything was totally like pro-black.
It's tough. Yeah, it was tough. Yeah,
but he was able to slip some stuff in.
And he had Lerone Bennett, and Lerone was very, very much an activist in his own way, and was very good for Ebony magazine. So a lot of these things, a lot of these things were transitional. A lot of these things were a product of their times, and sometimes because I'm a little older and I think more now about judgments that we make based on where we are today than we didn't live then, and we didn't have to face what some people had to face at that point. And so they made different decisions. Some people didn't make those kinds of decisions, and they took the hit, So, all right, so what else? Let me ask you this question. Do you think, and I'm going to throw this out, I guess, right? Do millennials of color today make any connection at all to the link between the past and the present as it relates to issues of race, class, and culture?
I think it's impossible to put us in a lump because I'm at the top of the millennial heap. Like, literally, the term millennial came from my folk, my people, because I graduated right around 2000, right? Like, that was what it was supposed to be. We were supposed to be those people. And I think I definitely have, right? Like, I think people do see the past, but I wonder how far back. And I wonder how many people were raised thinking that the civil rights movement is this thing in history books and we have overcome. And because I know that there's a lot of folks who are kind of in my age cohort who, because they personally are doing well and maybe their family is doing well and most of the people around them are doing okay, they were coddled into thinking that Sandra Bland couldn't happen to them. Sandra Bland attended the same church as my best friend growing up. So, it could happen. It could have happened to my best friend.
Is anybody here not familiar with the story about Sandra Bland?
Do you know what I mean? And she was sassy, too. So, I mean, it could happen. Just to be you.
So you think there is a connection based on all that's taking place around us?
I remember.
People are making the connection.
I think people more and more. It's sort of like it's building more and more and more. The more such incidents are happening, and what I'm hoping happens, because I think what's kind of putting it over the edge is the fact that there's so much documentation of it. Because it's not that it's new, right? It's that there's so much documentation and it's so readily available. And so I'm hoping what people realize is, gee, what happened before there was camera phones? Oh my God, this can't possibly be something that just happened because Obama got elected and people are mad.
You'll know. I'm sure everybody here has that thought. But within my community, that question is ever present, because those kinds of situations have always occurred. So now that everybody has this discussion about, well, now people are finally seeing that, and so people are, I think, to some degree, beginning to imagine, well, if this has been happening all the time, and we knew, there were no cell phone cameras and all of that. So. That means that historically things have been really bad for a long time, which we know, but
yeah,
maybe.
A lot of people, yeah, it's really, yeah. If there are people, it's so hard to put people in a lump, right? Like, I'm sure there are people who it still hasn't hit home in the same way yet, and sometimes it takes something to really hit close to home for you to realize, oh my gosh, I am not impervious to this thing that's far away from me.
And then there's your article, which says, what to do when you get arrested.
Yeah.
And that was what year?
1968.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. And it's scary. It's absolutely frightening. I wanted to, before we open it up, because I know folks probably have questions, and I'd be more than happy to answer
them. And we're going to talk about the music over there part of it before we open it up.
Yeah, for sure, but I didn't want to go through these little slidey slides real quick. Okay, so thank you to Zach, who came to my crib and took these pictures. This is a visual work that I'm building. Because this work, this particular thing, seemed to be really framed around this post-civil rights era thing, I left some of my older stuff at home. But this is, I call it ancestor worship. That's what I'm calling it. Because I feel a very particular way when I'm listening to older music. I don't particularly feel nostalgic, like, oh, I wish I was back then. What I was trying to express was this idea that listening to the music is literally transportive to another place in a way that some folks in Africa, when they're doing something called ancestor worship, they're like communing with older spirits, and it's not so much worship as it is communing and asking for guidance, and it's reverence, and it's all of this. And I wanted to kind of communicate that through music. And so what this is, and I'm going to show you some other details of it, but this is an old table and a Victrola. That Victrola actually works. The one at the bottom, the one above it, is an even older hand crank Victrola.
Is that in a case?
Yeah, it's in a case.
Okay.
And then above that, what that is, it's a radio horn from about the 1920s.
Wow.
And the mask is from Cameroon. So it's basically an assemblage of these items. Let's see if we can get another image. So that's the side of it. So you can kind of really see it's a horn.
How old is the radio on the bottom?
The one on the bottom is from 1941. I was able to find the catalog for it. And the one above it, I would guesstimate probably 1920s. It's pretty old. The one at the bottom, what I would love to, I listen to it actually pretty frequently. What I'm thinking about doing is doing a performative piece where I take the top kind of half off and I play maybe a J.B. Hutto 1940s.
J.B. Hutto.
Chicago blues, and assemble it together and do this moment of reverence. And this is also part of the reason why the records are there. Just this idea of this moment of ritual, like this is how we play this record and this is what we're gonna do when we're sitting and listening to this record, and this is the connection to this thing. And it's funny, little quick story, Zach was like, don't you wanna take those chords out of there? And I was like, no, I kinda like the idea that it works and that it's like kind of like real. I felt like taking the chords out of the shot would make it feel clinical and not functional. And I think a really important part of this is that it's functional.
And it's not Bluetooth.
No, it's not Bluetooth. No, it's not. There's a tone arm in there. So there's a close-up shot.
So talk about the mask a little bit.
This? That's just a close-up. I just really love the profile a lot. I love that the horn kind of resembles a neck, and that the legs resemble legs in the same sort of
curvature. I get it.
Yeah, that was sort of the intent, and that the larger one kind of resembles like a tummy. Like I was kind of going for sort of that. So now, just really briefly, there's some stuff that didn't make the show, so I'm going to show you guys the director's cut, right? So this is interesting. When we're thinking about past and present, this is from Soul Magazine. It says, would you believe Donny Hathaway is still a teacher? What's interesting is this came out after his first album, and he was one of these teaching artists in Chicago. Whoa, right? I was a teaching artist in Chicago. One of my students was Chance the Rapper. Whoa, right?
Like, I didn't
this
know
thing's
that.
Still, right. This
you
thing's
didn't,
still
you didn't tell me that.
That all these things still are happening, and there's so many really dynamic artists that are teaching artists in Chicago, and that Donny Hathaway was one of them. I was like, oh my God, this is awesome. So that's what this article is about. And then it says, in right here.
Says he has two albums, Everything is Everything.
Yeah, right. So actually, and if you don't believe that that's true, this article came out in 1971. Boop. And this is his master tape of Everything is Everything from 1970. I don't know, I just thought I'd show you guys that. So there you go. This is interesting. I kind of blew it up a little bit. This is notable because I've been doing a lot of research about the original Black Expo and how it became Push Expo and what Push, about Operation Breadbasket versus Push. And I know a lot of folks in this room are like, This is notable because this is something that was in Jet Magazine, and they covered this whole thing because what happened was, basically, just to nutshell it, was that Jesse Jackson broke off from SCLC, informed Rainbow Push, and brought a lot of people with him. And they were like, and people were really concerned at that point, I think it's 1972, were concerned with whether the split would impact King's dream. And it's like this is like a dialogue that is not in a lot of materials that are available to the general public, and it's a really important dialogue to have, I think. This is even better. Okay. So the way that I scanned this wasn't awesome. I don't know why it's doing that. Sorry about this. Okay, here we go. Come on now. Now it's not doing it. Let me click on this. That should do it. I have to move the mouse? Oh, okay. There it goes. Okay. So I'm teasing it out a little bit. This is from an old Billboard magazine, and it was a whole issue about the world of soul all over the country and all the different regional things. And there's like this whole thing about Chicago, and it made me really happy. And it says, Chicago to build a creative soul center. What? Like, that's awesome. And what it talks about, and you might remember this, Jerry Butler's workshop, yeah, among other things. Jerry Butler, if you're not familiar with him, he's just all over awesome artist. Who
Cook County Commissioner, Jerry Butler.
Yeah, he still performs.
He used to be, who is still, the Iceman.
He's the Iceman, right. But he also knew that his hits, because he had recently broken off with Gamble and Huff, who had kind of put him back on top because they were trying to do their own thing in Philadelphia. And he realized that he didn't have a songwriting stable at that point, and so he decided to invest in young up-and-coming writers and arrangers and etc. for his workshop, and people that came out of that included Terry Callier, and Larry Wade is in this picture, Billy Butler, his brother, Jerry Butler's brother, is in the picture. I'll go back so you can kind of see that, which is absolutely beautiful. And the other thing that's interesting is there's two articles that are in this issue that are really notable. One of them is from Curtis Mayfield, who's like, the next Black Mecca is going to be Atlanta. And this is like in like 1971. I'm like, you called it, Curtis. And he did move to Atlanta, as we know. If you don't know, you know he moved to Atlanta. The other article that's really beautiful is by Jerry Butler himself, and it says, Black music is getting intellectually involved. This is something that I'm actually writing an entire essay about, because what he's talking about is essentially this idea that Black music has been thought of as being sort of not serious music. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But even from the point of view of a lot of music critics that were like white, like the way in which they would talk about Black musicians would be like, oh, it's this natural, innate thing that they're creating, as opposed to it being an intellectual entity. And if you listen to his music during that time, it was very mature, thematically made for grown folks, and just really great. It's pretty wonderful, but I'm working on that essay. Let's see, where are we at? That's kind of small here. Folks might have seen this before. This is one of my photos from, it was in the other show. It's from Wilbert Holmes. Wilbert Holmes was a teacher. He taught photography at Malcolm X College, and he also was a freelance photographer for Jet. And the reason why I know that is because I have a Jet magazine that has his byline on it, which is dope. And I also know that because in the photo, it says course MX photo, which would have been Malcolm X photo, right? What? Yeah, so I thought, but this particular photo got from a junk shop on the west side, and it's really beautiful. There's actually three things you can see on here that are beautiful about how it's made. You can see two legs if you look closely behind the man, and he's holding a light. And if you look, there's actually instructions on how to take it on the other side, which is cool. And there's a little bit of ghosting of another person right here. Yeah. But it's fabulous for me. And it's also another interesting thing, as a person who collects records, there's also there's a salsa record that has a very similar pose from this time period. Not related, but cool that that was like an effect that was hot at that point. He also took a lot of pictures of ladies. I'm not sure what this was supposed to be for, but I think that it's kind of pretty. I love the color combination, and I would wear that outfit today. I'm trying to figure out if that's going to be the cover of my mixtape. I'm not sure. I'm serious, you guys. But anyway, you can kind of see over there, Wilbur Holmes, right there. It's a picture of a doctor and his wife. The wife is wearing hot pants, but that's, and this is just pretty. We're just going to leave it on that because it's pretty. But Hue was another one of the magazines that was created by Johnson Publishing, right? It was like Jet, but not news. It was more culture and a little beauty and a little bit of the fantastic blackness. Like, it was kind of fantabulous. And it's Catherine Dunham, who was born in Glen Ellyn, Illinois. I don't know if folks know that.
And by the way, I think she had a degree in anthropology from the University of Chicago.
From 1954. Gosh, those magazines are just worth their weight in gold. Because
she's got them all.
Yeah, I've got a lot of stuff. If you want to donate, find me after this, because we can work that out. But I just wanted to show you guys that because I get really excited about it, but I get even more excited about doing the Antiques Roadshow. Like, let me figure out the history behind this thing and what is this thing really saying? Like, what's it saying from an aesthetic point? But also, what is it, like, literally saying? Like, how is it filling in some gaps that maybe otherwise one wouldn't know?
And maybe for those people who may not know, because when we talked about Donny Hathaway, I don't know that everybody here knows about Donny Hathaway. Does everybody here, are you familiar with Donny Hathaway? Who's not familiar with Donny Hathaway? Oh, okay.
Oh, man, there's like three folks.
Two
okay.
People, right?
So
his importance to soul music was really, really.
Yeah, he went to Howard University. He studied music really deeply. And one other thing that's totally notable and that you don't get when you download the MP3 is his last studio album has this amazing, I don't know what you would call it, but this essay on the history of black music and how he wanted to intertwine all of these histories into this one album. I think it's in this gatefold. If you've never seen it, go to a record store and just find it because it's gorgeous. It's absolutely, and he writes out charts and stuff. Like, it's really deep. The last studio album, I'm picturing it in my mind, Extension of a Man, is it? I have a visual memory, so I have to picture it. It's weird. But yeah, that's the album. It's the one with Flying Easy on it, and you're looking at me, Valdez in the Country.
I was going to say, he and Roberta Flack made some really, really big records.
Yeah.
That crossed over pop as well as R&B.
Yeah, but he wasn't able to do the same crossover
for
as
his
solo
for his own
artist.
Records, yeah, right.
You know, there's the story when I was interviewing Sydney Barnes, who was in Rotary Connection, which was a group that Minnie Riperton was in. Anyway, great group. Oh my gosh, Jesus. But anyway, I was interviewing Sydney Barnes, and he was telling this story about when The Ghetto first came out. So that was his breakthrough. That was Donny Hathaway's breakthrough hit. And if you note here, it's on the, if I can get there, I'm gonna do my best here. Do I need to, I think I should probably just go back. Let me see. See, I'm moving my mouse two places that I should not be moving my mouth to.
Yeah, the record In the Ghetto was a 70s record, as a matter of fact.
Let's
it was a big
back.
Record.
We're going to move back. You know, like that. That could be time. Okay. So The Ghetto is on there. It's the track before the last track on there. When that came out, it was a breakthrough hit. And Donny Hathaway, people think that that's like kind of when he showed up in the music scene, but that's not true because he was writing charts and he was doing arrangements for a lot of folks, including Curtis Mayfield, doing a lot of work. The song Valdez in the Country, which wound up being on the Donny Hathaway Greatest Hits, was initially recorded by Soulful Strings for Chess Records. And he also did arrangements for Little Milton. I mean, just a really wide variety of people in the late 1960s. And so when people were telling him that they didn't want to hear his voice, that his voice wasn't commercial. And so when The Ghetto came out and it became a hit, this guy, Sidney Barnes, said that me and Donnie, we were in my apartment on Rush Street and we just cried together because I knew how much that meant to him.
And I brought him up to and flashed back on it because he was so important to the music, and a lot of people may not be familiar with all he did other than the one or two breakthrough hits that he had.
Where Is the Love?
His hits with Roberta Flack, but he was an arranger, a writer, producer. He did a lot of things, and he was very, very important to the music.
Oh, my God. And also, the French, right? You know, I get into this fight with the British cats and the French people who are trying to, like, quickly, like, decimate Chicago's record collections one by one. They come here and they buy everything because of, yeah. Well, now the dollar's stronger, so we're actually better off. But anyway, the French put out this Donny Hathaway compilation of unreleased stuff, and there's a lot of unreleased Donny stuff out there. Let me just say that. But they put out some very early demo tracks that he did, and you've heard that I've heard of him writing stuff for other people, but to hear him sing it is really interesting. And he had a bit of a lisp. I think that might have been why they were saying they didn't want to hear his voice, because he had a bit of a lisp. A lot of people had lisps.
But I didn't hear that in any of the Roberta Flack records, though.
No, by that point, they had worked it out. Yeah, I think Atlantic was like, we're not going to play that. We're going to get you some, you know what I mean? Because, okay, so Donny started singing. He was Donny Pitts, the six-year-old genius or something like that in St. Louis, where he was born in Chicago, but he grew up in St. Louis. So he was six-year-old, blah, blah, blah. He'd been singing all along, and maybe as a younger person, he had some of these things that had never been fixed. But ultimately, it got worked out. But some of these earlier recordings, you can hear it in the way in which he's singing.
And that is amazing how you can, there's some people who have that, and you don't hear it when they sing. Otis Clay is one that
right.
You don't hear
no
it when he sings.
Right, I had no idea he had a lisp. It was crazy.
Yeah. Bill Withers had a bad stutter growing up, mm-hmm. But he got rid of that.
Yeah.
Can we talk a little bit about why that part of this exhibit exists with the
totem?
Records?
Yeah. The record totem is for two reasons. It was in the other exhibit as well with a different configuration. The records are removable and we can switch them out with whatever we like. Part of the reason is that I remember a time that wasn't that long ago, and I'm sure it's still happening, which is kind of frightening, but there was a time when you could drive through the alleys and there would just be stacks of records, like stacks. And what was amazing about it was like hundreds of records, and you're like, someone put a lot of energy into collecting these things that at one point someone really valued and then they became like trash, right? And it says, okay, so what makes something trash and what makes something worthwhile to be elevated, right? So I wanted to build something that elevates it but doesn't make it just a pretty face, because maybe some folks have seen that they have now, they have these record frames, so you can take an LP, your favorite, you know, Rolling Stones LP or whatever, put it in a frame, put it on the wall, and bam, it's art. It's no longer a workable item. But what was important to me was that it has a front and a back that allows you to view the back, because I think the back often tells sometimes a more interesting story than the front, or at least as interesting as of a story. Those particular records, all to me, outside of the Through the Hard Way, I just wanted to put something in here that had something to do with Through the Hard Way. But the other images I felt were quite potent and communicated something today. Something different. Each one communicates something different. Yeah.
So. And by the way, somebody took one of the records out.
Someone in this room, I think. I don't know, but the Three the Hard Way was actually a sealed copy from 1974, and someone took it out of the sleeve or out of the seal. They
Dirty
took it out,
dog.
And I don't
Dirty
know why they
dog.
Did that. I don't know why it was supposed to stay sealed. I'm really sad about that, but I didn't have anything to do with it. No. You're looking at me. I know I didn't do it. I brought it here anyway.
And you tend to think, well, nobody would do that because this is a building that belongs to the University of Chicago. Who would steal a record?
Oh, I don't think
right?
they stole it. I think they took it out because for display purposes, but I think it could have stayed
that,
in
you know?
There. I think it could have stayed in there. I think it would have been okay. I think it would have been fine. But that's neither here nor there. It's neither here nor there.
So you must have some questions or comments for the...
Right. Well, they're all records that are there in the record totem. It's not all of the records because I think
you had a North Wind and Fire in there.
Yeah.
That's not on the
right. That was one that was one that I wanted to be in there, but it didn't make the cut. And I think the Earth, Wind, and Fire one is a great record anyway.
Ms. Talbot, earlier you were mentioning I guess the detriment, the damage and the beauty of operating as an artist between those two. You said it is a nostalgic, so what would you consider it?
It's not coming from a nostalgic place. I'm hoping it's coming from an empowering place, which is sort of a little bit different because I think a lot of this work that's when I talk about potency, that's what I mean. I think even though the era has changed, looking at an uplifted black face for me is empowering, whether it is a face from 1906, or it's one from last week, right? So I'm hoping that that's the takeaway, but I don't think that nostalgia is a dirty word either. You know, I think people naturally deal with the past in ways that what's the saying? Distance lends enchantment to the view, right? So I don't think there's anything wrong with that, but that's not necessarily the place that I'm operating from when I'm looking at these items.
Did you find particularly in Chicago, so artists, who's in charge or who's photographing or making the images for us?
That's a good question. There's this one guy, I want to say his last name is Bernstein or Berenstein. He did the majority of the art direction during the 50s and 60s at Chess, which is interesting, and his stuff came up for auction recently. And a lot of those photos are very interesting. And then, of course, you know, you've got with Blue Note, you had, you know, kind of the in-house production team with that. And I also have some interesting photos. I have a pair of photos that I got online. I purchased from a man who also took pictures in New York in the jazz scene. It's notable because in the auction, there was, the photos are from 1967. One of them is of Max Roach, the drummer, and one of them is of Abby Lincoln. And I felt like if I'm gonna get Max Roach from 1967, damn well better get Abby Lincoln too. And it was also notable that Max Roach's went for a lot higher than Abby Lincoln. But I was like, they're having a conversation with each other in the way that they're posed in the studio in 1967. And to have them split up, this is a situation where I'm talking about keeping collections together because these were his
photos.
Well,
they did split up. They got divorced.
I know they split up, but in that moment, they weren't split up, right? Like, so this is about communicating the moment, not looking at it from my perspective of what it is today, but what it was at that moment.
Sure.
And so, and then if you talk to Max, if you look at, there's a lot of interviews of him where he recognizes how important she was to him and continue to be to him.
Well,
and vice
versa,
but they went, I mean, you know.
They were both involved in the black arts movement.
There was a lot.
Big time, seriously.
You know, things fall apart, but they still, I still, freedom now, sweet. Yeah.
She was, she didn't play. She was pretty, you know, aggressive about the things she felt very strongly about.
And a wonderful actress as well. She's a wonderful actress, vocalist.
She was an actress. She was also, she... some years back, she won a beauty contest, Miss Black something or other.
She was banging.
And she decided, but she decided after that 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 was not particularly meaningful, and she decided to change directions totally and become an advocate for Black culture and Black rights, and that the beauty contest thing was just not productive. And so she completely stepped away from that. She was a good actress, too. She did a couple of very good films.
Yeah, for Love of Ivory was one of them.
Yeah, for Love of Ivory,
nothing
right.
But a man. But she was still banging the whole time. Never stopped being banging.
What's the last thing I love so much about records and record collecting? Could you speak a little bit more about the things about the record that was open, and then some things that came up was original issue, I guess I didn't know that it was a reissue, explain it, sealed, unsealed.
Thank you, plant. I mean, yeah. So, like, the thing about it is, as maybe people who are armchair cultural critics know, records are, like, hip again. But there's only X amount of records that still exist because there were so many records that were in the trash heap, right? Like, at one point, a lot of records were pretty plentiful, but there's some that were born rare and some that became rare through time. There's been a demand, and so there's a lot of reissues. So it's really freaky because they're like exact replicas of these old records, but they're not old, they're new. And so the value most of the time is a lot less than the original one. And if you find a sealed record that's 45 years old, generally speaking, it's fairly rare. I mean, and if not, at least it's in beautiful shape and you know it's gonna sound wonderful.
So all the reissues are marked reissue?
No, they're not.
So how do you know?
You know how I know? Because of the way that they're printed. They're printed on a different type of paper, generally speaking. And oftentimes they're a high quality scan of the original. So rather than being printed, what is it, CMYK, it's printed as in the way that it looks when you look really close up, it looks different. So you kind of have to know. Which is kind of deceptive. And every once in a while, it'll have something on it that wouldn't have existed back in the day, like a barcode or something. Like, that's a dead giveaway, right? Like, those reissues.
So let me ask you, what happens to the value of what you have if there's a reprint? I'll give you a good example. There are records that have, for years, were out of print, and so they became collector's items. Eddie Fisher's Third Cup was one of those records, and if you had one, you had an original one, that was like, you got the Third Cup, and then years later, it was a long space between when they right. started to reissue that.
And that was on Cadet Records. Yeah, he...
Not Eddie Fisher. This is Eddie Fisher,
not
a
the
guitar
white
player.
Eddie
not
Fisher.
Eddie Fisher,
yeah.
Debbie Reynolds
not
from
that
back
one.
In the day.
And some people are like, I don't know who either of those
they don't
people
know who
are.
That is, right?
Either of those are okay.
Is. Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm old. I've got to tell you, you know?
Well, you know, yeah, that one has been reissued. A lot of stuff has been reissued, and I think some stuff because it's like Holy Grail, but then at the same time, because of the digital age, it doesn't have to have been reissued to be available to people at this point.
So then how do you find out what the value is? Does it devalue what you have if it's...
I have found that it doesn't, because original still means a lot, I think, in the record world, but...
I had a record at one point that was... It was one of, it's a jazz record. It's Billy Strayhorn, who was Ellington's right hand. There's a record that he didn't record very many things himself, but there's a record called The Peaceful Side of Billy Strayhorn, which has strings on it. It's a beautiful record. And for years, you couldn't find it anywhere. I think it was initially issued overseas. Anyway, I had the record. Well, it was one of my prized possessions in my collection. And then it got reissued, and I was like, so... Kind of
I mean, the reissue doesn't, yeah, that doesn't, no. I generally speaking, if you still have, like, especially if it's an original issue from whenever that period is, it still maintains its value. And sometimes, and this is the thing with record value, it changes through time. Sometimes based on whether something's been sampled, whether something's played at a popular club in New York or in London, that can impact the value. All of those things can make it less or more. So, but generally speaking, a reissue is not gonna, sometimes it makes it more desirable because what it does is it makes people more aware of something. Like I have some original Chicago 45s that have been reissued by those British cats, and I've watched the value of it go just because now everybody wants it. They want, but people want, that are serious record collectors, they want that original swag. Girl.
It's a cute one. When they reissue some LPs, do they also go through the effort of replicating those sleeves? Because I've noticed like a lot of old LPs that I'll find in places, the sleeves are these big advertisements all of the releases from that label, and they have a lot of cool artwork and photographs and stuff.
Generally not, but that's because most used records that you buy are unsealed, meaning that they've been used. So you'd be privy to that, but the new ones are sealed, so you wouldn't even see that anyway until you bought it. That's the number one way you could tell that something is a reissue versus not a reissue is because the sleeve is either generic or it's a sleeve that is something else that's not like, if it was a Motown record, they would have had, you know, the Motown, the next new Eddie Kendricks and next to, you know what I mean, the Kim Weston and Marvin Gaye, It Takes Two, there'd be a little image of it, but and a little grid is generally what it was. But
now you're not talking about the album cover, you're talking about the sleeve inside.
The paper sleeve inside the
because
record.
Because on the album covers, on a lot of the reissues, it's not the same album cover. I mean, it'll have the same title and all that, and you'll say, nah, that's not the original one because it's different artwork.
In the 80s.
You know,
so. Well, now, then that's the other thing. There's like multiple eras of reissues, right? Like say an album came out in 1968, if it came out again in 1981, 82, blah, 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 maybe late 70s, sometimes they would try and put a different cover on it to make it look more updated, especially if the artist got popular again or something. They wanted to make it look like this is a new release, especially with jazz artists, they would do that. They would put a different cover on it. But now, the ones that are coming out today, they generally have the older cover because they're trying to make... Don't get me started about that, but we could get into a long discussion about dusty groove and how the grooves are not dusty, and it's very meta. you had a hand, and then.
So where do you place yourself? I mean, you play a lot of things, right? Like a cultural producer, an artist, an activist.
Roller skater.
There's a lot of things happening. Mm-hmm. Like, where do you kind of place yourself in this like long history of this kind of continuum, right? So you have an artist who made these things that you're really interested in, and it seems like you use a lot for inspiration often, just the way it sounds, the beautiful music, sometimes political. Like, where do you place yourself as an artist in residency here or in the world, thinking about this thing? Like, how do you think about yourself in relation to all of these materials?
Well, I think primarily I'm a media producer, and that's my art. So via radio, or I also write. I think that's my primary creation method. I do see myself as a cultural anthropologist as well, but the words kind of feel weird coming off the tongue. But I do know that the way in which I curate these things and think about these things and try and roll them around in my head is that. The other thing is that I'm really interested in, like I said, kind of not letting it just be this historical thing on the wall or in a box, but seeing how we can, you know, draw life back into them and let them have a dialogue with whatever is happening today. So it's kind of like, I guess, a three-tiered thing that I'm dealing with at this point. And then also, like, because we're not on air, I can say this thing that I would not normally say on air. You know how this is. You can't just say everything on air that comes to your mind because you have to take the responsibility because you're on air. I feel like a lot of people don't do that. Here nor there. Social media, right? People think they could just say whatever they want to say. But I do want to say, you were speaking on a panel, David Boykin. You were speaking on a panel at the Cultural Center over the weekend, and we had this discussion about this woman who was saying these things
that I thought, I personally thought they were kind of irresponsible just because she would just say it and leave it, and they were things that needed to have been unpacked for the audience that was there and what was going on. It was a panel that was supposed to be about healing and the Black community, but like the value of healing and healers and blah, 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 blah. But she said something that was kind of not related to that that really was interesting. She said, I might be paraphrasing slightly, but she said, how long will it be before, she's a Black woman, how long will it be before we're indigenous? That's not something that you would say if you, without unpacking if you were me on the radio, because there's a lot to that. And I would be remiss to my Native American brothers and sisters if I just say that and leave it alone. But what it made me think of was two things. Of a discussion I had with another person I produce a radio program for. She's Jamaican. And I was talking about the legacy of slavery and Jim Crow. And she said to me, oh, we didn't have slavery. I'm like, baby girl, how do you think you got to Jamaica, right? Oh, we're from Jamaica. I'm like, no, baby, you're not. She's not from Jamaica. But what has happened is, culturally, I think there's this indigenization that has sort of happened where people think that's their homeland. They know they're from Africa, but they feel like they're from there in a way that sometimes Black Americans don't feel like we're from here. So like, I feel like if this woman on the panel had perhaps framed it that way, I mean, I'm putting words in her mouth, but had it been framed that way, I think that would have been an interesting jumping off point. And I say all that to say, as I'm collecting these things, and as I'm thinking about ancestor worship, and as I'm thinking about the way in which we listen to music as Black people, and what we get out of it, and our cultural creation, and the way in which, you know, we dance, and all these other things, like, is this an indigenization process? Not to say that we're from here, but that this thing is our tribe, and this is this thing that is our inheritance, and this is this thing that's worth holding on to and collecting and building from and being proud of as its own thing. Not necessarily we're African, but we are this unique tribe thing. Because they stripped us of our tribe, right? Like, and now we are not that. But are we that, becoming that? Is this process becoming that again? Does that make sense? Right? So that's kind of what I'm, where my head is, like, building the case for that.
Okay, I got you.
Just, like, convoluted, but in the book, it'll be great. It'll be great. I'll just wrap it up.
Well, let me leave you with this note. And I don't want to spark a lot of major discussion on this necessarily, but it is interesting that in one of the display pieces over there that we mentioned before, this is out at Ebony, the psychiatrist looking at Black Power by Alvin Poussant. Mm-hmm. Dr. Poussant was very much involved with the Cosby Show. He, as a matter of fact, was the technical consultant for a lot of years based on family issues and how it should be presented and all of that. And it is interesting how, just in passing, that nobody's talked to Poussant, nobody's heard from him, nobody's interviewed him. I mean, he was very close to Cosby, obviously, with that show, because he was a major part of it, because they wanted to make sure that the Black family was presented in a way that was positive and that the images were right, and Poussant was an extremely important part of that whole process for all those years. So it's just kind of interesting that, because he's not dead, he's still alive.
He doesn't want to be on the Barbershop Show. He can't make it to the west side of Chicago Friday at noon. Yeah. You know, it's a weird thing, you know.
One of the other things is I was looking up some stuff connected with this conversation about advertising, African Americans being used in advertising. Cosby, in I think it was 74, he was the first Black personality to be used by a major company when Jell-O, the pudding thing, and that became so very, very big. And, you know, from that point and beyond that, there were large personalities involved with that who were African Americans. But he was the very first one and became huge. I mean, it became a point of comedy for a lot of comedians with Bill Cosby and the pudding, you know, so good the pudding, you know, kind of thing. But I do. I don't think we'll talk about that on the Barbershop Show about the fact that Poussaint has never been talked to. But I think it is an interesting point.
A lot of people who are connected to that show have not been talked to, Lisa Bonet. But there's reasons for that.
But Poussaint is more specific though because he's a psychiatrist, number one.
You know,
and would certainly have a view on what took place. Anyway, I just wanted to put that out there. So.
So how would you define soul music? And then the second question is, do you think that it still exists today? And if so, do you think it epitomizes it?
See, you know what? You're not a plant, but you're asking a plant question. So you're not a plant. I would define soul music, actually with the show Reclaimed Soul, it's a very, very loose term because it's just music that has a particular groove and an essence of heart to it, like really basic. It could be almost any genre, essentially. But when you talk about soul music, I'm specifically talking about a particular period of music that was really drawing from sort of a perfect storm of jazz and rhythm and blues and gospel in a way that was uniquely, at that time, uniquely American. So I think there's sort of there's like kind of a golden period, which I would say would be of soul, which would have been the early 1960s. Through to the 70s, and then people reclaimed the rhythm and blues terminology. They started calling it that again. I'm not sure why, but in the 80s, they just turned it back to R&B, which is okay, I guess. I don't know that the essence of it died. I think the term neo-soul is problematic because it makes me think that it's soul with a facelift. Like, we're just gonna put in this Fender Rhodes keyboard and it's gonna be soul all of a sudden. It's hard because I think the spirit of it is, I remove that from the genre. Like, I don't think something has to be like Leon Bridges kind of throwback sounding in order to be soul. I don't think that that's the case at all.
So if you create it on your laptop, can that be soul?
I think so. But then, you know, for me, like, the lack of real instrumentation makes me itch sometimes. Sometimes. I think it's all about how it's put together.
And I don't imagine this makes a big difference, but part of what the larger corporate presence did was take the Grammys and create the categories of, what do they got? About four different categories of soul,
right.
R&B, hip hop,
urban alternative.
Urban alternative.
Forget about that one. That's one of my favorites.
And radio stations did the same thing.
Yeah.
Radio stations, and I worked for stations a long time that were soul R&B stations, and they, in terms of the marketing aspect of it, some of them changed the designation so that they could be looked at by advertising agencies as a larger thing than just a black radio station. So some of it has to do with marketing, and the media plays a part too.
And I'm going to toggle that both ways as being a positive and a negative, because if you think about the fragmentation of radio in general, like there starting in the 1970s, there's like a million rock stations, right? Every single type of rock you could ever think of, like, was this unique station. And so the fact that we didn't have as many black stations was actually sort of limiting, I think, in a way. But if you go back in time in the way that black music was marketed from the time that records were initially marketed, it was just one generic little swath of race, right? And then it became secular and Christian, you know what I mean? It was gospel versus, you know, everything was sort of called blues. Even if it was jazz, it was called blues. Like, that was how it was labeled on the record, and then became this, and then became, you know what I mean? And then it started getting fragmented off. So it's sort of been cyclical in the way in which it's been talked about. I think it's also notable because when I talk to the musicians, especially from Chicago, they don't use a lot of those genre terms. They talk about the music. Part of that is because a lot of the session musicians were playing on gospel sets, were playing on jazz, were playing on soul, were playing all of these in tandem. So it's like I don't use the genres that much, maybe because of that, but I know D'Angelo, how about that? That's my long answer. I like D'Angelo's album a lot, actually. I think it's pretty great, but I don't know that it epitomizes soul in 2015 either. I don't know what that would be. I haven't heard it yet.
And you know, there was a period where, not a lot of them, but there were flashbacks, you know, like Boys to Men was like a flashback. Young guys were doing, you know, harmony, close, tight harmony, and it's kind of an R&B sound. Things change. I'm old school, I like that.
But in real life, and you know this, I don't even, like, when I'm listening to new stuff, very little of it is throwback sounding, because, like, I feel like it's been done, and it was done better, and you can study it all you want, Robin Thicke, but you're not going to be able to. It's just, it's for me, it's still going to be derivative.
Robin
and I
Thicke.
Don't have a, musically, I don't have a problem with Robin Thicke, but I'm saying that, come on, son, really? That's what I'm saying. That I'm saying that about a lot of people who you can tell they're very well studied. There's entire bands that are creating 60s sounding music, like Sharon Jones and the Dap Kings, right? But I'm like, you sound like you're from nowhere because you've studied all this music from all these different regional sources and just kind of created a mashup. And I don't know why exactly.
And that's where I don't want to speak to that, you know, as a musician, and not to talk about the genre, not to talk about the sound, is very much about the feeling, and about something that you feel that makes you call your soul and say that it's like, this is feeling, this is really your feeling. And I think you can or cannot have to. Regardless of time, space, whatever,
yeah.
If it makes you feel that certain way, and if you don't know what that way is, experience of any regard on the show live, and you know the feeling I'm talking about. And then once you have that feeling,
actually, what time is it?
Time to make a
move. It's going on right now. We can all go together on a field trip. Phyllis's. He said Phyllis's. They had to move, but yes, I'm in right now.
That's
a good point.
The most soulful, well, I can't say the most because there were so many great bands back in the day, but if you ever had an opportunity to see James Brown in his prime, when he had two drummers and dancers and the whole show, it was the most amazing, powerful show. You got three times as much as whatever you paid to see the show. It was an incredible production. That was the real funk, right? but as you point out, it depends on what you feel. I mean, if you went to see George Clinton and Funkadelic, that was a different kind of soul. Ohio Players, it's all, I mean, Earth, Wind, and Fire, different kind of soul, you know? So your feeling, how did you respond to it when you were sitting in the audience and you see people go absolutely berserk? As people did when B.B. King came to Chicago, people always went berserk. Place was full and people went nuts. B.B. King came out. When Smokey came out, I've never seen, there are only two or three people that I've seen get a reaction like that in terms of a female audience. Smokey was one of them. Teddy Pendergrass was the other. And I had the good, I'm old enough to have seen Sam Cooke perform once live. I have never seen anything like that in my life. And he was so gracious. He was a really handsome guy, had this incredible voice. And, you know, Teddy was kind of like, you know, I'm Teddy Pendergrass. I know you love me because I got it going on. Sam was a guy who, watching him perform, and Smokey's the same way. Like, every woman in the audience is like a queen. I mean, and Sam, this was about 61, I think, when I saw him perform in Florida. I was in the military and went to this concert. I have never seen anything like that. You talk about how you feel. I've never seen people feel and respond like that. I mean, even the guys, because Sam had that voice and that real incredible sound and soul and all of that. And so you're right, it depends on how you feel. You might feel that way at a jazz performance. Miles might make you feel that way, you know, or Duke, or Jimmy Reed, or Muddy Waters.
Yeah, it's not about, for me, it's not about the genre. But one quick story about Smokey Robinson. So first off, my grandmother loved Smokey Robinson and Pookie Hudson from the Spaniels, Chicago thing. Anyway, So she loves Smokey, right? But she doesn't even love the doo-wops. Like, she's a jazz person. She's not about that, but any day, Smokey, right? So Smokey, I don't know if you know this, but he has had this, like, soul food brand of food, and he was doing, like, this tour at grocery stores.
Yeah,
right. And he was at the Jewel on 95th in Stony. Oh, my God. The electricity in the place. I was trying to get some popsicles, and oh my God, the refrigerated section, everybody was a tizzy. I'm like, what's going on? Smokey Robinson.
I remember that.
Smokey Robinson.
Smokey.
It was crazy. It was some kind of, I don't know.
Does anybody remember that there was a commercial?
And the other thing is I also have one of the Soul Train Best of DVDs, which is a whole different thing, right? Like, because those took a long time to get out, and it's hard to get them because music rights and what have you and distribution for these old things. People don't want to pay money, whatever. But there is this performance of Marvin Gaye. I think he's doing Distant Lover, and he's singing. He's singing to this girl, this, you know, good-looking girl, young girl. And the way in which it's like they've known each other forever. The way he's able to just kind of, like, peel her back, and not in a sexual way, but in a, like, we have this connection is real, right? Like, the way he's able... That's something that you lose in an album, unfortunately. You can hear it, but you can't feel it. And just to, like, what you're talking about, like, I wish there was a way in which everyone could see through your eyes in 1976 to see, 1978 probably, to see Teddy Pendergrass at that moment. I just, oh my God, right? Like, that moment was like everything, and I wanted to be that girl so bad. It was so intimate, too, because this is the other thing about Soul Train that people forget. Everybody remembers all the lip syncing of it and kind of, you know what I'm talking about? But there was a lot of live performances, and there was a lot of a cappella, and you would have Smokey at the piano singing with Aretha Franklin, Ooh Baby Baby, like a version where it's just them and the piano.
If you've never seen that, that is an amazing, it's on YouTube.
It's on
somewhere.
YouTube now. Like, there's a lot of stuff. If you know it's there, you can find it. And it's
That's
like,
incredible. About 2 minutes long. That should have been packaged in. It's amazing. Let me just say this real quick thing about Smokey, though, before you go. If anybody remember this, there was a commercial it was an oldies commercial where you can buy the, you know, the CD with the, like, flashback stuff. And it was years ago, and people still remember it, where there was a guy, a young white guy, and his father was getting on him about playing the music real loud. And he was getting into his car. I think he had a T-top or something. He was getting into the car, and his dad was saying, "Turn that music down." And he said, "But Dad, it's Smokey." The impact is absolutely incredible.
Yeah.
Well, look, this is about the time to kind of wrap this up. Ayana, how long is this going to be here, as a matter of fact?
Where's that sheet of paper? You all have a piece of paper in your chair. August 23rd, thank you.
And there'll be...
I did my bit, right? I did my bit.
There will be other discussions with other people who are...
There will be other discussions that you can read about on that piece of paper. It's right there beside you.
So can we give Ayana a little bit of applause? We've been doing such a great job. And tell your friends... Tell your friends about it, and don't forget to check out Reclaim Soul on Thursday nights from 8 to 10.
Yes, on 91.1 FM, and if you can't get 91.1, toggle around a little bit on your dial, you might be able to get a little fuzzed out. I mean, it's a long story. Mm-hmm. It is on the interwebs. If you Google Reclaim Soul on the old SoundCloud, you'll be able to get some archived material at your leisure.
And the barbershop.
The barbershop, man, it airs all weekend long. Fridays at noon and Saturdays at noon and on 91.1. And Sundays at 3 on 91.5. And like I said, it's a show that I am the executive producer of. And Richard is the host and leader, fearless leader. And it's live from a barbershop in the North Lawndale community of Chicago. That was the community that Martin Luther King was based at when he was...
up here in 1966 fighting for open housing. And that particular barbershop was not at that original location, but it's been in business for many decades in North Lawndale, and it's an important barbershop in that community. So that's why we're there. She's a plant. You can stream. You can always stream vocalo.org and WBZ.org. They are sister stations.
And by the way, we don't say this a lot. People can stop by the barbershop. We like to make sure the shop has enough chairs for customers, actually, which happens. But we're at 3622 West Sunday.
On Fridays.
A lot of people listen on WBEZ on Sundays and think we're live. Don't go to the shop. People have gone to the shop and been very disappointed, but they got a really nice fade. But they were very disappointed that it wasn't live. So, Friday.